Welcome everybody to Sustainable River-Based Management, Module 5, Part 3. We have been talking about assessing sustainability and looking at ways of doing so. And I've just introduced to you the basics of systems components, and we will be talking about systems thinking right now. First of all, I want to look into identifying feedback loops, and I want to show you one example of how this could be done. Not always these feedback loops are immediately obvious, and very often we may think of what is a driving force or what is the actual feedback loop in a system, where we may later find out that this is not actually the one that triggers the observed results or the observed impacts. And when we identify the appropriate feedback loops, we can then efficiently also trigger changes. So this is an example that I want to show you here. It's an example of a positive feedback loops towards a common agreed goal. And this was developed in some protected area which is undergoing restoration. The good part is that the team was able to agree upon a common goal, and that goal was the self-sufficiency and the restoration of the park, achieving self-sufficiency and a restored beautiful park. Very often already this can go into very different directions, because there may be ambitious individuals, ambitious organizations funding parts and pieces of something which may fall, actually lead to many sub-goals falling, breaking apart the overall goal that initially might have been in place. So good is, in this case, there was a common agreed goal in the first place. And then the feedback loops were identified in a brainstorming exercise. So people were brought together, or individuals were asked, and or groups of people met and discussed one and the same thing, and the feedback loops were identified and cross-checked against the various proposed ideas, and an agreed list came together. First item, also considered and perceived as the most important one, was the amount of secured resources. In this case, it excluded resources obtained from revenue generation. The second perceived as important was the level of research, monitoring, and efforts going into conservation. The third level perceived as important was the level of financial sustainability. The fourth, the level of planning and coordination between the park itself and the institutional stakeholders and the stakeholders of the region. The fifth was the number and quality of implemented tourism in the park. The sixth, the level of collaboration from the communities surrounding the protected area. The seventh was the quality of law enforcement taking place. The eighth, the healthiness of the ecosystem functions. Now, we try to limit this to a number below 10, because it becomes more blurred when we increase the number of possible feedback loops. It does not add to the understanding and the simplification of the system. Even in this case, we will see later that 8 is actually already over the top and not simplifying our system's understanding. We'll see it in a second. Now, the numbers that we hear here is a perceived importance. And again, this very much depends on how strong our lobbies are, how strong individuals are, how convinced each and everybody is, how convinced the individual departments are of the role and importance of their departments, and so on. So this is a perceived importance, which was, however, agreed upon through these various discussions, the exercise that took place. And then we established links between those, all analyzing those against our agreed and accepted overall goal. Those were expert discussions, which took quite some time and led us to an agreement, agreed decision on how each of those individual loops actually link to each other and help us get to this common goal. Now, the result of this gives us an analysis of the strengths of each of these feedback loops. So we have an outgoing and an incoming element to that. Taking our eight loops and connecting each of these loops to each of the other identified loops. We have, for instance, in the case of the number and quality of implemented tourism in the park, this will impact positive on this one, and it will impact positive on the level of collaboration from the communities, and for the rest, it will be on the receiving end. All of the other actually serve as triggering loops to improve the number and quality of implemented tourism in the park. So when we list this analysis now from simply drawing these connections and checking each of these connections against each other, we can see that there are two of these perceived feedback loops which happen to be not feedback loops in themselves. They're actually one of them is a driver, because it initiates all of these other loops. It keeps all those loops driving, functioning, working. And then we have one which is receiving all of these initiatives. So all of the loops, whatever the individual loops are doing, actually move or input directly on this level of financial sustainability. So overall, the level of financial sustainability turns out to be not a feedback loop, but an outcome. And then we have here various other loops, which in itself are important, but there's not a single one which one would pick and say, this is the one that triggers all the rest. They are very much nested with each other and depending on each other. So we could regroup probably some of them and group them into one or two and end up having maybe less of loops, and in that respect, less of interventions, and less maybe simplify our hierarchy of the system. Now, when we place those identified positive feedback loops, putting our driver at the bottom here as our point of initiation, and putting our outcome to the top, this is what we want to achieve over the years, maybe a 20-year or 5-year period, whatever the frame of our intervention is. There are those different links in between, or the feedback loops in between, which will take us to the set outcome. And now those can be as the outcoming and incoming be organized. The highest outcoming, incoming, highest outcome, and as it reduces, we add them to the next higher level. And the order here, as per the perceived importance, as perceived from the expert inputs, as amount of secured resources appears to be the very strong or the strongest in this, then the level of research quality of law enforcement would be almost at the same level and could be maybe put under one and the same effort, one feedback mechanism here, and the same for the next level here on number and quality of tourism, community, ecosystem health, which would be essentially a result of the interventions taking place at that level. So we may, if we would put all of our efforts into this feedback loop here, we would not be able to achieve this because we will not be meeting the driving feedback loops as identified in the system. If we would put our effort in one of those here, we probably will automatically reach the other aims, the other levels without having to put to artificially move or accelerate these loops here and still reach the level of financial sustainability as our overall outcome. So this is very interesting because, as you can imagine, individuals will be very strong on their points of why one or the other thing should receive more priority. And as this has been an agreed process and all these individual steps were agreed, the analysis was agreed, this actually became very useful as an instrument to change the system's approach and prioritize resources in a very efficient way. Now, let's look into the system archetypes, or we can also call them paradigms or system traps, as the one of the driving mechanisms of systems feedback loops. So such system traps could be, for example, our current economic model that is based on growth and consumption. We've just discussed it. A system trap could also be the poverty cycle and the measures that we take to overcome that poverty cycle. And the system trap is also our current city or urban model, the parasitic cities, as we discussed them earlier. Now, we should not lose hope because such system traps can be opportunities if they are recognizable in advance. That's a condition. If the recognition is being possible, then it should be used to identify ways out of the trap or ways to avoid it. So two steps: understand it first, recognize it, next is to be able to take interventions and implement them. And it, in any case, requires the system structure to be changed, and this may be quite painful in some cases. So this means the goals have to be reformulated, the feedback loops have to be changed overall, and we may have to add new feedback loops. Now, let's focus on these system traps right now. And I'm following the examples given by this author here. The kinds of traps that we have are balancing feedback loops, the commons, the low performance, escalation, the competitive exclusion, the dependence and burden shifting systems, the appearance of achieving goals and wrong goals. And we will be discussing them right now. Let's start with the balancing feedback loop. It has a stabilizing role, as the term suggests, as a balancing mechanism. However, it can create resistance to change. Very often we see that we are trapped in an unwanted system. Actually, no one likes it, but everybody spends considerable time and effort to maintain that actually unwanted system. Examples are very, very abundant. Just look into the poverty alleviation schemes, for instance, Bread for Work, where you put people to work to get food, which will not help them to move out of the poverty situation because they spend all their time just to get some food for today. Another very predominant example are the fertilizer subsidy schemes or the electricity for free schemes, the subsidy schemes which provide groundwater or facilitate groundwater abstractions, but on the other hand create groundwater markets. At some point it was positive, but very useful, but then it gets to a point where it becomes an established system which has so many external beneficiaries that it is very difficult to move away from it. So the ways out of this would be a definition of larger commonly shared goals, and it would also help to harmonize the objectives, to focus back and see why this initially was introduced, what was the initial idea of it, and see whether this can be achieved through different mechanisms, if the subsidy would be slashed back or applied in a different way, if the overall objective could still be met. The next of these traps are the common systems, and we also often hear the term the tragedy of the commons. What is meant by this is, this is an example of a lake here which has changed color because somebody dumped something here. It's in a public space. So we see a tendency often of over-exploitation of renewable resources, the overusage of common things, just like this example. Those are shared places where pollution is dumped. And very often we see the tendency that every user benefits directly, but shares the costs of its abuse with everyone else. So the common systems, in a way, make selfish behavior more convenient. It can be hidden, and it's profitable, rather than a behavior that is more responsible or more lasting for the whole community or the future. An example are the discharges of pollutants into rivers. How can we overcome such misuse of our commons? We can educate and exhort people. Those would be about the consequences of unconstrained use of commons. This is presenting facts or presenting values and trying to send a message across to people and make people change. It appeals to morality and social disapproval. There may be through the social disapproval system of social monitoring, where people watch out for what the other people are doing, what the neighbor is doing, and in that way a community in itself, a society in itself, could take care of the commons. It's very, it had been very established in traditional societies, this social monitoring of the commons, and is something that has been lost or forgotten in our today's societies. Another way of overcoming misuse of commons is to privatize commons. That's just another approach very much in our today's economic and social views, a solution to divide and make people live the consequences of their own actions. It's not solving the issue as such, but it builds on the view that if you destroy something, if you pollute it, at the end you will be suffering from it, which, however, is in the case of the commons very often is not possible, because the impact may take place, the negative impact will take place in one location, and it will be suffered very distant, very often from that impact location. But the logic in this is that people may destroy their own resources and in the same way not harm all the other people. It doesn't work for people below the poverty line, where people have no access to alternatives, where people have actually a very short life expectancy. People cannot really think beyond tomorrow or beyond today. Such mechanisms would not be working, and the major impacts right now we see on pollution, land degradation, is often driven by livelihoods restrictions as a result of the poverty situation of these people. So it's a possible option, but it's not one of the very successful ones. First of all, because of the character of the commons, and second, because it does not really include and work for a major part of people in our societies. And then the third of these possibilities is to regulate commons, and this means that we may work with prohibitions, restrictions, rationing, we may have quotas, permits, taxes, incentives. But the backside on this is that this must be monitored and must be enforced. Otherwise, it doesn't make sense to have regulations, and it must be made enforceable also. Now, the next on these traps that I want to discuss here is the low performance trap. This means that we have performance standards shifting based on past experiences. We take off with one standard, and as we gain experience, as people come and go, and knowledge comes and goes, our performance standards may shift and change and deviate. So the desired state of the system is influenced by the perceived state. This is very important, that this is not independent from each other. We are defining our performance standards, and we also define how we perceive the current state of our system. It can result in negative feedback loops and a shift to low performance when performance is measured against worst cases. Just a phrase to that is how when people say how things used to be or how life is. Yeah, if we cannot touch upon what life is, because some elderly person knows and should know, but we as you as younger or as a professional, you know that things can be changed, but you are stopped in your implementation because it's an established frame, and that is untouchable. So this leads to a low effort, low expectation, and low performance scheme. And we see this in many countries, many societies, that this can not take entire systems down and keep them at a very low level. Now, what can be done instead is to keep absolute standards or to use goal-sensitive standards based on a best pass performance. Yet another trap that I want to discuss here is the so-called escalation. It's a reinforcing feedback loop, which leads to exponential growth and eventually to collapse. And we have discussed this previously on population growth, on our economic growth models, our relationship of source and sink in our resources use. This is called escalation. We often see this as a positive exercise in the beginning, because we use competition to keep ahead of someone else. We measure ourselves and put ourselves into such a frame. There are very often incentives given to this kind of competition, and then it becomes very difficult to step out and to stop this. There are possibilities, but very difficult in a group situation or in a society as a whole. We can refuse competition, we could interrupt this reinforcing loop, and we could create new balancing loops to control escalation. This is a mechanism which may help in some of this, but it may only add, in some of the cases, new complexity by just adding a new balancing loop, which may, after all, still drive us into the collapse, into the final escalation. So this is very difficult, very tricky, but it is possible. And then another loop, another trap that I mentioned also previously, on water, when we talked about water scarcity and water rights, that is called competitive exclusion. It actually departs from the view that success influences following success. That success can be born by professional intervention, by learning, but very often that success is built into a sort of a cultural heritage, which give an advantageous position, then add up to following success. And this leads to a resources appropriation, which is the danger of it. It leads to the domination of access to resources, and it leads to the elimination of competition, and finally also the elimination of diversity. And we know that saying that the rich become richer, the poor become poorer, and this essentially expresses this, that that process. We may have examples like the land ownership again attached to resources access. Land ownership is sometimes linked to the right to vote, or the right to access to certain services, or public influence and influential positions. The farmers is one group of people affected by this, as an example. The water rights system I mentioned before, also mentioned before, the labor division based on gender. Those are a few examples, but you can find many more of those as well. So what can be done, and sometimes is also be done by state regulations, we could have a diversification. We can aim at that individually. Our institutional frameworks can help us increase diversification. There could be mechanisms that lead to what we call a leveling of the play field. We are resetting the clock here and increase the advantages for weaker or removing advantages of the strongest. A mechanism that sometimes has been used but may not be very successful are quota systems. And we see in some countries also antitrust laws or policies or regulations that aim at exactly avoiding accumulation of such successes and avoid this domination of processes. Now, another trap I want to mention here is the dependence and burden shifting system. This is seemingly a good initiative as such. However, it actually only reduces the symptoms of a systemic problem. It hides the actual solutions. What happens is that this goes along with a loss of control. It goes along with an increased vulnerability and the loss of the adaptive capacity. Examples of those in our context of the water resources management are the dependency on subsidy schemes, or the reliance of farmers on fertilizers, the dependency of our current economy on oil, the dependency of a region on desalination for water supply. And the ways out of this are to remove the focus of interventions from a short-term relief to long-term interventions with an emphasis on long-term restructuring or long-term reforms. And this is very hard to achieve very often, but it's the only way out of something that is only trying to firefight a situation without actually going into the fundamental problems of the system. And then a trap that I want to discuss here is the appearance of achieving goals, so-called. This is a set of rules which are developed and create a distortion in the system. The self-organizing capabilities of a system is used in a negative feedback loop. So this means that it provides the appearance of obeying to rules, or it seems that we do everything to achieve the goals, but in reality we use or abuse our systems capabilities, our self-organizing capabilities to divert our strengths in negative feedback loops. So examples of this are, for instance, the farmers who would lose their water permit if he or she uses less water, though that person may have harvested much more because that person had invested into some water saving technologies. So it's backfiring because that person may not need so much water anymore, or it may not need water at all because it uses a different farming methodology and still contributes to the society, contributes to the economy in a positive way. But this doesn't matter because it's not measured for, and it's not part of the established systems scheme. Another example, which may be sounding familiar to you, is that institutions receive less money in the following year if they have spent less money in the previous year. So it might be interpreted as a lacking management capacity to use money, to spend money. But on the other hand, if money was spent wisely or efficiently and all the goals or targets were achieved by using less money, it's a punishment for that very institution to receive less money because they could use that same amount of money to achieve more in the following year by using the same efficient, wise application of their funds. Another example are water users who pay for pay a very high service charge, although they consume less water, just because the water supply system is designed in such a way that it requires high operating costs. That's again one of the examples. And what can be done is it requires the redesign of the rules, which would allow the system to release its creativity to or its self-organizing capabilities to achieve positive feedback loops. So all these initiatives here, actually positive feedback loops, which need to be, there should be space given possibility to explore those and make them available in a positive, towards a positive outcome of the entire system. And then finally, I want to bring up the trap that is called wrong goals. This is an effort that is the case. We call this wrong goals when we have a mixing, a confusion between efforts and results. We see this that goals of feedback loops define the direction or the behavior of a system. We have seen this in our example at the beginning. And if those goals are defined wrong or set wrong or incomplete, then the system will end up working towards achieving an unwanted outcome. So if we define our system's goals wrongly or incompletely, if we define our loops wrong, then the achievement will be responding to what we set ourselves, but it may actually lead to a completely unwanted outcome. So this, the result of this could be that we follow all of ourselves, follow perfectly the rules and procedures which nobody intended and nobody wanted initially. Examples are our safety discussions of how much control do we need in a society to achieve, to reduce crime rates, for instance. And we can overdo in a way and not achieve anything. Or we could, another example would be the gross domestic product, which I brought up earlier, which was set up to measure consumption or income generation in the first place at country level. However, later was actually being used to assess well-being. And so it's mixing up two different things. Either we continue measuring our economic economic flows, and by that we, for that we can use our GDP, or we have to define a different indicator if we actually intend to measure the prosperity or the wealth of our humans in the system. Now, what this means is that we have to overcome such wrong goals is to we have to redefine our goals and also redefine the indicators in such a way that they reflect what we actually intend to measure and what we intend to achieve, what we want from our system. With this, I want to stop the discussion on assessing sustainability in river basins and the various instruments that we have at hand for that. I'll see you next time again.